Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. Today in this video we will see how to interface the LED dot matrix with STM32. We will use the SPI peripheral of the STM32 to do so. This video will focus on a single 8x8 dot matrix display, which is connected with either MAX7219 or 7221 ICs. Although I don't have a separate single display module, so I will use this one. It has four display modules cascaded together, but still we will only focus on this particular one. Just ignore what's going on with the rest three and only focus on the first one. If you have ever tried interfacing these modules, you might have come across their types. There are different libraries for each type, for example, FC16, Parola, IC Station, Generic, etc. In this video, we will not focus on any type of hardware, rather we will write the code according to how it displayed the output. I don't know the type I have, so I will write my code based on trials and errors. You will understand it in a while. There is a good article on Arduino++, which explains the reasons for these different types, and what are the differences between them. Basically these MAX7219 and 7221 ICs are originally designed for the 7-segment displays, so they are capable of controlling the 64 individual LEDs. However, there are no standards for mapping the 64 LEDs into rows and columns. Therefore, depending on hardwares, either the rows or columns can be wired as digits. Also, their increasing order is uncertain. The point is, no matter what hardware you have, you will be able to display characters on it. The only issue you will face is, either the characters will be mirrored horizontally, or vertically, or they might be rotated. In this tutorial, we will see how to deal with such issues. As I mentioned, I don't know what hardware type I have, so I will prepare my library based on some trials and errors. Here is the datasheet for the dot matrix display. This is not an official one for the MAX7219, but it is smaller in size, and it has all the required information. The device requires 5 volts, and you should provide the voltage externally. This is because there are a lot of LEDs, and they will consume a lot of current. This might damage the MCU, so it is better to provide the voltage using a battery, or by some other means. Let's take a look at the connection before proceeding ahead. Here is how the display module is connected to the STM32F103 MCU. The pin PA7 is the MOSI pin, which is connected to the data in of the device. PA5 is the clock pin, and it is connected to the clock pin of the device. PA4 is the CS pin, and it is connected to the CS pin of the device. The display is powered from a 5 volts battery. As I mentioned before, it is advised to use the external power source for the dot matrix display. This is because the LEDs will consume a lot of current, and this might damage the MCU. Let's continue with the datasheet of the device. I will just cover the important points from this datasheet. Here you can see the serial data format. The device works with 16-bit data transfer. Out of these 16 bits, only 12 bits are usable. Out of these 12 bits, the higher 4 bits are the address bits, and the rest 8 are the data bits. Just keep this in mind, as we will set up our project according to this. We will check the rest of the datasheet later. Let's start the Cube IDE and create a new project. I am using the STM32F103C8. Give some name to the project and click Finish. Let's start with the clock setup first. I am choosing the external high-speed crystal to provide the clock. The Bluepill board has 8 MHz crystal on it, and we will use the PLL to run the system at maximum 72 MHz. Now go to Sys, Debug, and enable serial wire. Now we will enable the SPI1 in the half duplex mode. We don't need to receive any data from the slave device, so half duplex mode is fine here. You can see that the clock and MOSI pins have been configured automatically. We need to manually enable the chip select pin, so set the pin PA4 as output. Let's rename it to CS. We only need 3 pins from the MCU, let's configure the parameters now. Let's set the data size to 16 bits, and the data should be sent in the order most significant bit first. There is no particular requirement for the baud rate, so I will keep it around 2 megabits per second. Make sure that the clock polarity is set to high, basically the clock should be high when it is idle. This is the requirement in the MAX7219 datasheet. Now go to the GPIO configuration, and set the default state of the CS pin to high. This will keep the slave disabled by default. That is all the configuration we need, click Save to generate the project. Now we need to initialize the device first, and here are the available registers on MAX7219. Here the first 8 registers are for writing the data into the respective column. And the next few registers are for initializing the display. The decode mode register, with the address 9 hex, decides whether you want to use the CodeB fonts. These fonts are designed specially for the 7-segment display. Writing 0 to this register disables the decode mode. We should keep it disabled while using the dot matrix display. Next we have the intensity register, which decides how brighter the display will be. The higher the duty cycle we choose, the brighter are the LEDs, but they also consume more current. So choose this value keeping the current consumption in mind. Next is the scan limit register. This register decides how many columns we want to enable. Our display consists of 8 rows and 8 columns, so we will enable all of them. Then we have a shutdown register. Writing 0 to this register shuts the display down, and writing a 1 enables the normal operation. At last we have the display test register, which is again used in the 7-segment display. So we will keep it disabled too. We need to write the values we discussed into these registers. To do that, we will define a new function. The parameters of this function will be the address where we want to write, and the data what we want to write. Now, as we already discussed, the device expects the data in a 12-bit format, with address bits being the higher 4 bits. Therefore, we will define a new 16-bit variable where we will store the address and data combined together. The address bits should be at the higher positions, so shift them left by 8 places, and then add the result with the data byte. If you notice the register addresses, they are actually 4-bit in size. Therefore, our 16-bit variable actually contains 12-bit useful data, which is as expected by the slave device. Now we will send this data to the slave device. To do so, first pull the CS pin low, so to enable the slave device. Then call the function holSPItransmit to transmit the data in the blocking mode. Here the data expected by the function is the pointer to the 8-bit unsigned array. So we will pass the address of the 16-bit variable we defined. After transmitting the data, disable the slave by pulling the CS pin high again. Now let's define another function to initialize the dot matrix display. Here we will write the data to these registers. Let's start with disabling the decode mode. Write the data 0 to the register 9 hex. Next we have the intensity register. I will keep it low, so I need to write a 1 to this register. Next is the scan limit register at the address B hex. Here we want to enable all columns, so we will write the value 7 to this register. Next we have the shutdown register at the address C hex. We want the device in the normal operation mode, so write a 1 to this register. At last we have the display test register at the address F hex. Write a 0 to this register, so to disable the display test. So that is all for the initialization. Let's call this function inside the main function. Alright, now we will write some data to the device. We have the 8 columns to write the data into, and their address ranges from 1 hex to 8 hex. The data will also be sent in the similar manner, with the higher 4 bits being the column address, followed by the data itself. Let's assume I want to write the data 1 to column 1. You can see the display on the bottom right corner of the screen. Just focus on the first display, and ignore what's going on with the rest of them. You can see everything is random on the display. Although just take a look at the last row, there is only the first LED turned on, and this is as per the data we sent. The rest of them are random because we did not write any data to them. So whenever we are writing data, we must write to all the 8 columns. Let's write a new for loop, which will be used to send data to all the 8 columns. Inside this loop, we will send different values to each column. Basically, the value in column 1 will be 1, column 2 will be 2, and column 8 will be 8. You can see the result on the display. According to the output on the display, our column 1 is this row in the end, and the data is being written from left to right. Column 1 has the value 1, therefore only the first LED is on. Then column 2 has the value 2, therefore only the second LED is on. Then column 3 has the value 2, therefore both the first and second LEDs are on. You can see the rest of the columns also follow the same rule. So now it is clear that the columns are increasing from bottom to top, and the data is being displayed from left to right. Remember that this depends on how you are viewing the display. If I rotate the display 90 degrees, my rows become columns and columns become rows. That is not the point here, we just want the display to print values according to our reference. So for the rest of the video, please keep in mind that the reference is how you are seeing it right now. I don't really care if the display is rotated, or if I should view it from a different angle. Now we need a tool to generate the data for the characters. We can do it ourselves also, but it will be very time consuming. Here is the tool, which can do the job perfectly. Set the width and height to 8, byte order to column major and big endian. I don't know if these settings are correct as per the display, so we will first test them. Here the gray pixels are the ones which we want to turn on. Click generate to generate the code. If you note the values, they are written according to the columns. But for us, the columns are actually the rows, the two starting from the bottom. So this is definitely not what we are looking for. Let's change the byte order to row major. Now the data is a little more convenient, but it is starting from the top. You can see the value F8 hex, it is the second row from the top. Then there are three empty rows, and then we have the value FE hex. As I already mentioned, our columns start from the bottom, but we can still work with this data. Let's copy it and paste it in our code. Now inside the for loop, we will pass these data values to the display. Since the value of I is starting from 1, we need to subtract 1 here, so that the data element can start from 0. Let's flash it to the board to see the output. You can see the output is not quite what we were expecting. There are two issues with the output data. The first is that the data is being written from right to left. And the second is that the smaller row should be on the top, but here it is at the bottom. The second issue is understandable, this is because the values are generated in a way that the columns are increasing from top to bottom. But we want it the other way around. So instead of passing the first element to the first column, we will reverse the order. We will pass the 8th element to the first column, 7th to the second, and therefore first element to the 8th column. Let's see the output on the display. The second issue has been resolved with this. The smaller row is on the top now. The first issue still remains though, the column data is being written from right to left. Let's change the endianness to little endian, and generate the code. Copy it to the project, and let's see the output on the display. You can see that we got exactly the same data that we drew in the tool. Now we have got the configuration for the display I am using. There are three major things here: the byte order should be row major, little endian, and we should send the last byte first. Let's say I want to print this smiley on the display. The configuration is the same, so let's just copy the generated data into our project. Now build and flash the project to the board. You can see the same smiley face printed on the display. So we can now create any character to print on the display. You can generate the entire array of the characters, and if you have any doubt, you can just refer to some display picture. For example, if I want to print the number 3, I will simply design it here, then copy it to the project and display it. I did generate the array of numbers while I was testing the display. Here you can see the data for the numbers ranging from 0 to 9. The variable char data is a matrix with some rows and 8 columns. Now we will write another function, matrix data, which will print the number on the display. The parameter of this function will be the number that we want to print. Here we will again write the for loop, and inside it we will send the data bytes from the array we defined. The data bytes will depend on the number we want to print. The array is arranged in such a way that the row element of the array contains the data bytes for the respective number. For example, row 0 contains the data for the number 0, and row 6 contains the data for the number 6. So here we just need to pass the num parameter to the row of the array. The column contains the 8 data bytes, and we will send them in descending order. Now inside the while loop, let's write another for loop, which will send the numbers from 0 to 9. Each number will be printed after a delay of 500 milliseconds. Alright, let's build and flash the project to our board. You can see the numbers from 0 to 9 are printed on the display every 500 milliseconds. And after the number 9, there is a delay of 1 second. So everything is working as expected. We are able to interface the dot matrix display with the STM32 using the SPI peripheral. Note that I still don't know the type of display hardware I have, but using some trial and error, we were able to make it work. We will continue the rest in the next video, where we will cascade the rest of the displays, and finally write the code to control all 4 of them. This is it for today. You can download the project from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching, and have a nice day ahead.